Juvenile or cold soccer has become the backbone of Ghanaian soccer since ages.
When we started playing football, we were not using boots, we were playing barefooted. And when we started using football boots, you know what? We play in the boots the first half, second half, we felt uncomfortable, we threw the boots away.
I remember in 1965, during the Kenya's Independence Day, we were asked to go to Kenya and exhibit the Ghana brand of football in those days. On Sunday, when we met them, we beat them 13 goals to nil, a Kenya national team. And Jomo Kenyatta was there.
Its positive impacts led to the creation of National Juvenile Committee, the NGC, by the Ghana Football Association, the GFA. In the early 90s, it was given the mandate to manage juvenile football in Ghana, hence the selection of Starlets Under 17, which is the junior side of the Black Stars. Strongly enough, NGC started its work by recruiting Colts footballers around the country to form the National Under 17, the Starlets. Amazingly, they led Ghana in Under 17 World Cup in Italy for the first time and won the cup with players like Ni Odatelamte, Yao Prekun, Emmanuel Dua, Ben Owu, Isaac Asare, Sebastian Bynes, Daniel Addo, and the rest.
Well, it was in Accra here. I started with great Falcons, but then I couldn't have a team because they were bigger and I was very young, you know. And then I moved to great Mohammedans. So even that early age, both two teams were fighting over me. I quite remember when we were going to register at AMA, Falcons wanted me to register for him and then Great Mohammed. So it was a big fight. I mean, the Falcons were trained, but I'm their player and so forth. So I couldn't register for any team. It was a policeman who escorted me home. So when my mom saw me, she was a bit nervous. And so she said, well, if it's so, then I should go to my father. At that time, you know, there was divorce, so my father was in Kumasi and I was in Accra. So that's how I ended up going to Kumasi.
Ghana's name suffered strongly in the world stage after beating Spain 1-0 in the final match. And the Ghanaian squad was a delight to watch. Also in 1995, Ghana Starlets went to the World Cup in Ecuador, beating the favorite Brazil in the final match to win the cup, and two-time runner-up in 1993 and 97. In New Zealand 1999 World Cup, Ghana placed in the third position, and in South Africa 2007 World Cup, Starlets came in the fourth position. Ghana has qualified in four consecutive Junior World Cup, starting from 1991, 1993, 1995, and 1997. Convincingly, Ghana was applauded by the world, and all loving fans in Ghana saw the good work of NGC, now NGA, the RFA, and the GFA on the face of national juvenile soccer in Ghana. Colts club holders who raised this great place were neglected in the recognition. Though former juvenile Colts players who played Ghana Under 17 eventually graduated to play the Ghana Black Starlets under 20 and later promoted to play the Matures under 23 and finally the Black Stars, the senior national team. During the process, most of these players were exposed to the world market and they continue their football career playing professional clubs in Europe, Asia, and other international clubs. Much emphasis was not put into Colts football, although it's the foundation and the backbone of Ghana soccer. Note therefore that these players who gave Ghana this achievement are players who were discovered and nurtured by local Colts clubs around the country and who have sacrificed their money and life not to become wealthy, but only for the love of the game, to give a kid a future they deserve. However, there has been a decline in Colts football in Ghana lately. Also, Juventus soccer team has not been seen in the world stage for some time now. What would it be? We must find out from some experts.
The formation of juvenile clubs started in the year 1931 by one Mr. Teacher Mensah. And it was then at Jamestown before it spread to other suburbs in Accra. We were fortunate to witness the passing out of Mr. Chiemesa. And we took over from there with Mr. H.K. Akwe. From H.K. Akwe, it came to my turn. Between that time and 2006, we were running the clubs autonomous. We were not under the Ghana Football Association. We did our own thing by getting sponsors from some corporate bodies around 2001. So from since then, we have not been able to get any sponsors to assist the development of juvenile football. That was the beginning of our decline. You know, between 1978 and 2005, we can say with all confidence that the number of players that were produced in those times became the backbone of the Black Stars. If you talk about players like Abedi Pele, he played for Great Falcons Football Club in the year 1976-77. Now, if you talk about the current juvenile football, we are too many in the country for us to determine exactly what we are, we will be able to do. You see, in those days when the number was only about 20, we were able to manage and play the game to the best of the children's ability. And it attracted so many spectators. Formerly, we were using only anklets and kneecaps. That was affordable. But now, the player must get his own pair of boots, if possible, his training kit. It is very difficult to buy boots for all the 105 players in a club. What we can do best is that the good ones, we try to encourage them by buying the kits. If a player desires to play for us, if he gets some small money, we top it up for him to buy a pair of boots. These are the difficulties that is preventing us from achieving what we all desire. You know, so we pray to the Ghana Football Association to come to the aid of these football managers. If you look at it carefully, those who organize juvenile football are people of the lower ranks. All that we are doing is for the nation. We have kept the children out of the street. It is these days that we have this sakawa that is giving us a headache. But in those days, we were able to remove all the street children from the streets, and they have been able to fend for themselves as I talk to you now. They have their own houses, they have their own businesses, you know. So it was a great thing for the nation. Here I would blame the FA for not organizing or operating a table for the juvenile clubs. The FA Secretariat, because they know very well that there was something like solidarity for the juvenile clubs. If you have a field where you have four or five clubs playing on that pitch, and they train in the afternoon from 3 to 6 o'clock. How many, what can you do? Where you see the coach driving is where there is a field for only one club. He has all the time to organize himself. But in general, all the playing fields that you have has more than four clubs, making it very difficult to give a good training to the players involved. If you go to Nima, from morning to 6 o'clock, you see children playing on the field of play, on the pitch. If you come to Alaju, we have about four clubs. If you go to Kotobabi, we have more than six clubs, even a second division and a third division. So the decline is due to inadequate pitches that we don't have. Ghanaian players are very ungrateful. For all these years that we've taken care of them, if they reach the highest level in football, they forget where they came from. They do not remember whether there was a team called Great Falcons for them to even to come and visit, or even to come and pay a working visit to their training park and say, "Oh, Charlie, this is the boy that we produce." So now, it will give encouragement to other players to emulate, but because they don't do it, those who pass out to also fail to do it. So their Ghanaian players are not very grateful, I must say.
The whole story of the juvenile started in Accra proper, where Accra proper means the Choco, Mamprobi, Bukong area. That's where the Colts started. There are nobody in his right senses who want to do Colts football in those days, because it was just for nothing. And in those days, you bring out the player makes the name. Then the big clubs like a House of Oak and others will just pick them, and if I say House of Oak, I don't mention Kotoko. Then I'll be seen to be biased. And then you mention House of Oak, you have to mention Kotoko. Because, and they are the big things who have been cheating us all the time. This I can say, and say it big and loud, that these clubs have been taking our coach players, even in those days. But these days, when you take our player, you have to pay something. Why am I talking of money? Now there is nothing that you can do in this world without money. Not now. It was and still is that you cannot do anything without money. You know, and that is why I will call on especially the corporate bodies to come to assist running of these juvenile clubs. Ghana is noted all over the world as the beacon of hope for football in Africa.
Coast football is in decline, because all we are doing is we're just looking at the top. We are not looking at the root. We need to get sponsors, because I don't think Coast Club will be spending too much money as the likes of Division 1 or Division 2 and the Premier Division. A little from sponsors will make it fun. We need competition. And now, why the coast clubs, the coast system is going down is because we have a lot of academies. But it's good for the competition. And not everyone can play in the academies. But everybody can play in the coast system, because academy, I know the academically you have to be very clever, you have to bet them. We know in the coast we have some great players. They can't read and write, but when they are on the pitch, trust me, what they can write with their legs, like you writing with your hand on a piece of paper. So we need to bring the cooperatives into the system. Go to them, see how they can help you.
My name is Godfrey Adiobe. I've played in Germany for many years, 15 years. When they talk about football, I've seen a lot in football. I'm one of the guys that I've seen a lot in football. So I'm advising you, don't be jealous of each other. Don't rush to get what you don't. Even when I was in the national team, there were some players, even when they get injured, they don't understand why they are injured, because they have someone protecting them. They said they have one juju man protecting them or something. And there was this thing on this interview on internet radio I heard, there's one man called, I don't know, some name. He's a juju man in Ashanti region. And he was, they interviewed him in a Focus Radio. And they were telling them, they have one famous player in the country that he has been working, he has been doing juju for that person. And the person wants him to come and live in Accra. And he said he will not come because he has about 200 acres of cocoa in his village and no one stores there. And Accra is very good. So you see, if you do all this juju, it will come back to you. The devil doesn't give anything for free. It's only Christ that gives things for free. So I'm advising you, there are a lot of juju things. When you were even at the Winneba camp, when you train, after training, no one takes his eyes off his shoes because you think someone might sprinkle a powder or something in the shoes and he will get injured or he cannot play again. How can you live in a team like this? We are all one, but we are scared of ourselves. You cannot even take a soap from someone to bath because we are scared. You don't even know where the soap is coming from. And people are doing juju against people, and people are scared to sleep in the same room with his fellow teammate, brother. So you should stop these things. Stop doing juju because it will definitely destroy your life. Look at how many players that they have gotten themselves involved with juju and they are now suffering. They don't even have a penny to spend. But when I went to Europe, no one does juju. They have their own thing. We just pray, get together, and then shout and do something to motivate ourselves, and there we go. And we will still win. So you see, many of the World Cup, they come and then they win the World Cup after we go into juju and everything, doing juju, putting water and other things on our, Florida water and other things on our bodies. That, still, they come to take the cup away.
As an administration, that's the way we look at post football. We want to look at it as the pillar on which our football rests. You know, so definitely, the FA takes a very serious view of post-football. We have a national juvenile committee made up of very knowledgeable and hard-working gentlemen who are committed to face the challenges of post-football and make sure we have things running in place. The FA is also considering the establishment, the plans are quite advanced for the establishment of a national youth soccer academy to pick up players from post-football and then other academies to expose them to a lot of very solid training and preparations to make them very high-class and credible professionals in the future. Among some of the main strategies that the committee has recommended to the FA is the issue of books and boots. That is to say, we want to encourage schooling amongst footballers. So a lot of preference and premium will be given to talented footballers who are also going to school. In the past, you know, the notion has always been that football and schooling are substitutes. You can't do both at the same time. You are either schooling or you are playing football. And even if you're a talented footballer in school, our system doesn't encourage you to combine both. You know, but this is something we want to encourage because an educated footballer has quite a lot of value. So these are some of the main principles that we are looking at as an FA.
But there's a way out if they can do to assist by way of sponsors. They should be able to get sponsors for the mainstream of juvenile football. That is, at every national competition, they should ticket up for all the whatever it takes to organize it. It will give encouragement to the organizers of juvenile football to aim at their level, at that level. Other than that, we will not be doing Ghana any good. The advice I can give is that we should keep proper records of all that we do, because formerly we were doing the thing haphazardly. Now that it is now scientific, we should be able to organize ourselves in such a way that your records keeping should be adequate enough for the future, because you don't know when a player will hit the limelight and you will be asked to produce certain documents which will enable you to retrieve what you had earlier spent.
I'm the sports administrator with the National Sports Authority. I'm the one in charge of sports for Accra Metropolitan Authority. So I'm director of sports for AME. And we are those who organize sports right down from the basis. The AMA is yet to collaborate with the FA so that we form some committees about how to develop juvenile soccer at the basis. I think something must be done concerning that because we are in charge, but look as if the FA is autonomous. So there should be collaboration between the AMA and then the FA.
Comparing our time, those times, like to this time around, I think the performance is low, and then the standard of playing has come, and I think it's down. I think they should work on it and then try and find a way to bring it up.
We should encourage more scouts across the country to be able to, you know, target talent. So when they get a talent across the villages, because I remember in my village, we used to have very talented footballers, but they never had the exposure that they need to really get into the national team. So if we send scouts across the country, we'll be able to unearth and then identify very talented footballers. And from then, when they graduate to under 17, they graduate to the under 20 level, meteors, and then they can get to the Black Star.
We're really happy to support PFM Media in the drive to further support Colts soccer. The Colts soccer is really important for us as an organisation. Our balls are perfectly suited to those teams. They last a long time, and we really hope that over time we can build relationships with Colts soccer. And so the team behind this documentary should be commended for their approach to promote
during our time. We started playing Colts. It is not easy. We didn't find it easy at all, but those days we were not wearing boots, we were playing barefooted, and before maybe you go to training and come back, you get problem in your house, but your mother don't want to play football. Those days, if you are playing a Colts ball, they thought you are a ruffian ball or something like that. During our time, we were playing better than this, and the coach chairmen were organizing the coach more than this. If you are in Accra right now, I will sell you about four or five only pitches, and always the pitches are busy. Maybe the second division, and then those days, the time we were playing coach, no second division, no division one. And this time too, the FA have to help the coach to develop, because without the coach, you have to play course and forget that and the academy. When you play course, I think everything will be okay for you. And they should forget about traveling, and stay inside the country and play more before you travel.
The beginning was in 1931, when Teacher Mensah, with his colleagues, teachers who were tutoring the children how to play drums, that they wanted to form a brass band. So they always convert at their various places, like the schools, and when they have free time, or when the tutors were not around, they took to the field with socks and to play football. And the interest, people who went by or passed by also saw something good in the players, so they selected and they were encouraged to form coast teams. So that's how it all began. Coast have played a significant role in the development of football in the country, because if you should see somebody who have passed through the juvenile team, who have gone into any of the premiership or any of the divisions, you see the difference in the way they played, because they start very early, and that gives them more time to develop their skills. So anybody who have passed through the course of juvenile football is quite different from somebody who have just grown up and just taken to the field, you see the difference. The first team which played in the World Cup, the 100 and whatever players they invited to come to play in the national team were all products of the juvenile game. So this is how far Colts have helped this country. And I pray that we'll continue to develop the Colts football, and that will also help in raising a very formidable national team. And it will also interest you to know that players like Razak Ibrahim, Derek Boateng, and quite recently, Daniel Ajay, who was in polls for the national under-20 team, and currently one of the goalkeepers in the senior national team. So, and I can also say that when Accra House of Oak won the club championship, that is the African Club Championship, BT International had 8 good players in the team. You can talk of Ajugu, Jacob Nete, Amakwa Mreku, and the rest, even Emmanuel Yati, were all products of BT International. And we'll take credit for that, that we'll be able to make good players and at least winning this championship. We are still playing, and we hope that by the special grace of God, we'll continue to produce more stars for Ghana football.
We must make Colts football the backbone that it deserves. To make the loving fans of Ghana proud, we must emphasize on the development of Colts football. Long live Colts football. Long live Ghana football.
El polvo, ponte de pie y vuelves al ruedo. Y la presión se siente. Espera en ti, tu gente. Ahora vamos por todo. Te acompaña la suerte. Samina, mira, sangre de agua. Porque esto es África. Samina, mira. Waka, waka, Samina, mira, sangre de agua. Porque esto es África. Africa, Samina.